If you are looking for a blessing, do not linger here. Here is only emptiness, a hollow, a husk, where a blessing used to be. This blessing was not content in its confinement. It could not abide the unrelenting silence, the pressing stench of death. So if it is a blessing you seek, open your own mouth. Fill your lungs with the air this new morning brings, and then release it with a cry. Hear how the blessing breaks forth in your own voice, how your own lips form every word you never dreamed to say, how the blessing circles back again, wanting you to repeat it, but louder, how it draws you, pulls you, sends you to proclaim its only word. Risen. Risen. Risen!
I was buried beneath my shame.
Please rise and join in singing.
Who could carry that kind of weight? It was my tomb till I met you. I was breathing but not alive. All my failures I tried to hide. It was my tomb till I met you. You called my name and I ran out of that grave. Out of the darkness into your glorious day. You called my soul. Now your freedom is all that I know. The old made new, Jesus, when I met you. You called my name and I ran out of that grave. Out of the darkness into your glorious day. You call my name and I ran out of that grave. Out of the darkness into your glorious day. I needed rescue, my sin was heavy, but chains break at the weight of your glory. I needed shelter, I was an orphan, now you call me a citizen of heaven. When I was broken, you were my healing, now your love is the air that I'm breathing. I have a future, my eyes are open, 'cause when you call my name, out of the darkness into your glorious day. You call my name and I ran out of that grave. Out of the darkness into your glorious day.
Hallelujah! Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed.
Hallelujah. Happy Easter, beloved, and welcome to St. Mark's. It is good to be with you and welcome to our guests both here and online. Tracy's got some announcements for us.
Just a little. Most of the things you've seen on the slides are in your bulletin. Just want to, real quick, when we flower the cross, let you know how that's going to work. That will be at communion time. You'll come up, you'll flower, you'll get your communion, you'll go to your seat. Notice the flow. Wah. If you are in the lovely wing over there, you guys are going to come around the back. And then you'll get to go. Wah. Okay. You'll notice we have some lovely flowers up front that were dedicated by many of our folks here today. This is just a little heads up. At the end of the service, please take them home with you. All right. You good?
That's what
we're good. All right.
Friends, we invite you to turn and face the font as we give thanks for the gift of baptism. Joined to Christ in the waters of baptism, we are welcomed, restored, and supported as citizens of the new creation. Let us give thanks for the gift of baptism. Wash away our sin and all that separates us from you. Empower our witness to your resurrection. Strengthen our resolve in seeking justice for all. Satisfy the world's need through this living water. Where drought dries the earth, bring refreshment. Where despair prevails, grant hope. Where chaos reigns, bring peace. We ask this through Christ, who with you and the Spirit reigns forever. Amen. Alleluia, Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed.
Alleluia, Christ is risen. Alleluia, Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed.
Alleluia. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. God, you gave your only Son to suffer death on the cross for our redemption, and by his glorious resurrection, you delivered us from the power of death. Make us die every day to sin, that we may live with him forever in the joy of the resurrection, through through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. I invite you to be seated.
I'd like to invite the kids up for a children's message.
You guys want to go?
I think we're going to be here-ish. Y'all come over here. Come over here with me. Thank you. You can sit on the thing. How about that? Come on now. Come on. Come on. Hello, Miss Alice. Do you want to come sit over here with our friends? Come over this way. This way. This way. This way. This way. You got it. We can sit on the floor, too. That's okay. How are y'all today? Yeah? Happy Easter. You hide the eggs. Oh, we hid the eggs and you found them? Oh, very good. Very good. You didn't? Not yet? Well, guess what? We have more. Okay. What I have here is, you tell me. What is this? Mary? A crown that they put on Jesus that had thorns on it. What do we think? Is it pretty?
No.
No. It's pretty ugly, isn't it? Could you imagine if you had to wear this? It'd be pretty painful too, wouldn't it? Yeah. That's not very nice at all. I know. But you know, the other night... The other night, we laid this on the cross. Because why? Jesus died on the cross. Jesus wore this crown of thorns. Not perhaps this one, but one like this. Right? Oh, hey, Samuel. Hey, friends. Yikes. Okay. Oh, my goodness. You just make me so nervous. How about we come over here? We got you. It's all good. It's all good. Whew. Miss Judy was watching you. Okay. So, what we have is we have our crown of thorns that I left up there that's ugly, and it was on this crown, or on this cross, because we were showing how Jesus died. But now, what do you see that's showing up on the cross? Flowers. And then later in the service, we're going to add even more flowers, because out of that death, out of that ugliness, comes life. Jesus rose again. We get life, and we get beauty, and we all are get to be a part of that. What do you think? Yeah? So when it's time, I want each one of you to make sure you put a flower on that cross, and then when we're finished, we'll hold it up, and we'll admire it, and we'll take it outside, and you can even get your picture made beside it, and it's a celebration of life. It's a celebration of Jesus rising from the dead, right? Of that resurrection. Okay, so I tell you what, let's pray together. You ready? Can we pray? Yeah? Show me what you do. Thank you. Good job. Dear Lord, we are so incredibly grateful for you as we praise you on this beautiful Easter morning. In your name, amen. All right. Yep, all kinds of people talking. How about you head back to your seats now, okay? Okay. Samuel, do you want to hold Elizabeth's hand? There you go. Okay. Okay. Yep. Okay. You go sit down.
Good morning and happy Easter. The first reading today is from Acts 10, verses 34 through 43 in the Pew Bible, it's page 895. Peter began to speak to the people. I truly understand that God shows no partiality, but in every nation, anyone who fears him and does what is right is acceptable to him. You know the message that he sent to the people of Israel, preaching peace by Jesus Christ. He is the Lord of all. That message spread throughout Judea, beginning in Galilee after the baptism that John announced, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with the power, how he went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil, for God was with him. We are witness to all that he did both in Judea and Jerusalem. They put him to death by hanging him on a tree, but God raised him on the third day and allowed him to appear, not to all people, but to us, who were chosen by God as witness, and who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. He commanded us to preach to the people and testify that he is the one ordained by God as judge of the living and the dead. All the prophets testify about him, that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name. The word of the Lord. The second reading is from 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 1 through 11, in the Pew Bible on page 935. Now I would remind you, brothers and sisters, of the good news that I have proclaimed to you, which you in turn received, in which you also stand, through which you are also being saved, if you hold firmly to the message that I proclaimed to you, unless you have come to believe in vain. For I handed on to you as of first importance what I in turn had received, that Christ died for our sins in accordance with the scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas, then to the 12, then he appeared to more than 500 brothers and sisters at one time, most of whom are still alive, though some have died. Then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles. Last of all, as to one untimely born, he appeared also to me. For I am the least of the apostles, unfit to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God, I am what I am, and his grace toward me has not been in vain. On the contrary, I worked harder than any of them, though it was not I, but the grace of God that is with me. Whether then it was I or they, so we proclaim, and so you have come to believe. The word of the Lord.
Gospel according to St. Mark, the 16th chapter. Glory to you, Lord. When the Sabbath was over. Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James, and Salome brought spices so that they might go and anoint him. And very early on the first day of the week, when the sun had risen, they went to the tomb. They had been saying to one another, "Who will roll away the stone for us from the entrance to the tomb?" When they looked up, they saw that the stone, which was very large, had already been rolled back. As they entered the tomb, they saw a young man dressed in a white robe sitting on the right side, and they were alarmed. But he said to them, "Do not be alarmed. You are looking for Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He has been raised. He is not here. Look, there is the place they laid him. But go, tell his disciples and Peter that he is going ahead of you to Galilee. There you will see him, just as he told you." So they went out and fled from the tomb, for terror and amazement had seized them. And they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
I invite you to be seated. Grace and peace be to you, from God our Creator and our risen Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Dear friends in Christ, who shot JR? The third season of the show Dallas ended with quite the cliffhanger. Some of you already know that. J.R. Ewing, the oil baron everyone loved to hate, had been shot by an unknown assailant, and it seemed like just about everyone had a motive. The mystery wouldn't be solved until 8 months later, but in the time between, the question was on everyone's mind: who shot J.R.? It showed up everywhere, from the costuming of other sitcoms like Father Ted to that year's presidential election. The episode Who Done It, which revealed, spoiler alert for a 40-year-old television show, that J.R.'s sister-in-law, Kristen, was the shooter, was at the time the highest-ranked television episode in U.S. history, with more Americans tuning in to watch than voted in that year's said presidential election. And it wasn't just a phenomenon in the United States. Queen Elizabeth asked Larry Hagman personally to reveal to her the killer's identity. And a session of Turkish Parliament was suspended so that legislators could get home in time to watch the episode. I'm not making this up, folks. Even today, it is remembered as one of the greatest cliffhangers in television history, as evidenced by the fact that someone who was born after this aired knows about the episode. And so many shows have tried to repeat Dallas's success using this formula for cliffhangers. The Simpsons did it with Who Shot Mr. Burns. And other shows have tried to find their own plot twists and turns. Everybody loves a good cliffhanger, a twist that catches you by surprise, a mystery that isn't easily solved, an ending that hints that there is more to come. Because in truth, a good cliffhanger isn't an ending at all. It is an intermission with the promise that there is more to come, and that it is going to be worth the wait. And while there are some who would still say that Dallas did it best, that is by no means the first cliffhanger. 2,000 years before anyone ever asked who shot J.R., Mark the Evangelist ended his gospel with something of a cliffhanger. See, after hearing all of the stories that make up the narrative of Holy Week, the central narrative of the Christian faith, we come to this most holy morning. We have heard in this past week the stories of Jesus' triumphal entry into Jerusalem, led by cries of Hosanna and palm branches strewing his way. We have heard the story of the meal he shared with his disciples, how he washed their feet and fed them, knowing that only hours later one would betray him, one would deny even knowing him, and the rest would disappear into the night. We have heard his dying words as he hung on the cross. We went and saw the tomb where they laid him, and still we knew that we hadn't come to the end. The tension was palpable. The drama was reaching its height. And in the early morning, on the day after the Sabbath, some women went to the tomb. Now, we've heard this story before, so we know how it ends. Christians in 2024 hear this story, our minds go straight to the resurrection. Maybe we're already jumping to the other evangelists' accounts, like how John describes Peter and the beloved disciples' foot race to the tomb and Mary encountering Jesus in the garden. Or maybe we're thinking about those other resurrection encounters that will follow, like the story we'll hear next Sunday about Thomas, who is so often unfairly remembered only for his doubt. Or the story we'll hear the week after that about those disciples who walk with Jesus on the Emmaus Road. But for a moment, dear church, for a moment, try to picture this scene just as those faithful women encountered it. They were on their way to a tomb that they were unsure they would even be able to access, to anoint the brutalized body of a man who was dear to them, whom they had watched die. When they arrived, they saw the heavy stone rolled back. They went into the tomb where Jesus' body should have been, and instead they saw a young man dressed in a white robe. By the way, where the other Gospels identify this as an angel, Mark uses the word naoniskan, the same word used to describe a follower of Jesus who fled naked from the garden when Jesus was betrayed. They see this young man and they don't see Jesus, and Mark says they were alarmed, which I imagine is putting it mildly. And this young man says that Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified, has been raised. And he gives the women instructions to find that ragtag band of deserters and deniers and send them to Galilee, because Jesus still has a plan for them. In terror and amazement, the women flee the tomb and speak to nobody. Dear church, roll credits. Tune in next season to find out what happens. This is the end of Mark's gospel as the evangelist originally wrote it. And if that feels incomplete to you, friends, you're not alone. If you were to look in your Bibles, you will find not one but two later revisions that try to tie this story up in a neat bow. The second half of verse 8 and all of verses 9 through 20 in Mark 16 are in brackets in our Bibles, because scholars have recognized that this is not the same writer who wrote the rest of Mark's gospel. but someone attempting to resolve the cliffhanger. And I can understand that, because as much as a good cliffhanger can be a fun way to end an episode of a TV show or a chapter of a book, actually living in that kind of uncertainty and discomfort is deeply disorienting. It's no wonder that Mark tells us the women didn't immediately share this news with anyone. They must have felt like their worlds were absolutely coming apart. Just days ago, they had seen someone they loved endure something nobody could possibly survive, and now a stranger in an empty tomb is telling them something even more impossible has happened. It has all the elements of a story that will keep you on the edge of your seat, a twist that catches you by surprise, a mystery that isn't easily solved, an ending that hints at more to come. But that, friends, that is all we get from Mark. There is no resolution. But maybe Mark understood that, like every great cliffhanger, this is not an ending at all, but an intermission with the promise that what happens next is going to be worth the wait. On Easter, when we look at these last verses of Mark's gospel, it is also important for us to look at the first verse of Mark's gospel, the beginning of the good news of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. Mark 16, verse 8, is not the end of the story. It's the end of the beginning of the good news. The story is still being written. It was passed on to Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James, and Salome. It was passed on to Cephas, then to the 12, to more than 500 brothers and sisters, to James and the apostles, and then to Paul. It was passed on to Lydia and Phoebe and Rhoda. It was passed on to people like Augustine and Aquinas, to Luther and Calvin, to Sojourner Truth and Frederick Douglass, to Oscar Romero and Dorothy Day, to saints whose names are known to us, to saints whose names are known only to God. It was passed on to our grandparents, to our parents, and to someone who cared very deeply that the story continue to be written through you. We still live in the tension of the cliffhanger because the story of the good news of Jesus Christ is still being written in your lives this morning. The message through which also you are being saved will be written when you go out from this place into a world that looks at empty tombs with suspicion and despair, with terror and amazement. The message that Christ died for our sins and that he was raised on the third day will be spoken when you interact with those who are mourning the loss of what is possible without ever considering that God can yet bring about the impossible. Dear church, so often we affirm that the cross is not the last word. It is not the end of the story. Death is not the last word, but it is just as important for us to understand the truth of Easter is that the empty tomb is not the last word either. The cross and the empty tomb stand as witness that your salvation is secure. But the newspaper headlines and the television broadcasts remind us daily that God still has work for disciples just like you and me. For deserters, for deniers, for those who have done the unthinkable and had a change of heart, for those who have had the unthinkable done to them and need their hearts to mend, For we who run our mouths far too quickly and far too often, and for we who fail to speak about the things that matter. For we who seem to always find ourselves in the wrong place at the wrong time, and for we who never dare to show up at the right place when it really counts. For we who have faith that can move mountains, and for we whose weak faith can create mountains out of molehills. Beloved, God is not finished with you yet. There are two promises in this Easter story. The first is that Christ is risen indeed. And that is true. The second, the one we too often forget, is that he is going ahead of us to a place where we will see him, because there is work for us to do. Resurrection is a gift, yes, but it is also a team sport. And we have a role to play in speaking new life into dead hearts and dead hopes. Christ is risen indeed, church. But the story doesn't end there. This is only intermission. And what happens next, I can promise you, is going to be worth the wait. But we have to show up to find out. So come. Come and mourn at a blood-stained cross and marvel at an empty tomb. Take your time in the garden to process your terror and your amazement, your hurts and your hopes. And when you have done so, go out from this place with eyes wide open to see the risen Christ. He is waiting for you with a promise and a purpose. May you embrace this Easter work, and may the impossibility of resurrection become possible to you and through you. Amen. I invite you to rise in body or in spirit as we join our hearts and voices in our hymn of the day, hymn 365, Jesus Christ is Risen Today. with the whole church, beloved, let us together confess our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshiped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sin. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Rejoicing that Jesus is risen and love has triumphed over fear, let's pray for the church, the world, and all those in need of good news. Holy God, we pray for the body of Christ, the church. Where the church is persecuted, protect it. Where the church is privileged, grant it humility. Where the church is fractured, heal it. Guide us all to embody Christ's love in the world, God of grace. Life-giving God, we pray for the earth, your good creation. Join our prayers with the branches lifted in praise and roaring waters of new life, that together we may proclaim Easter hope, God of grace. Merciful God, we pray for all peoples and nations. Free oppressed communities from occupation, exploitation, and abuse. Teach leaders your way of justice. Empower peacemakers and all who work to end violence and strife. God of grace, liberating God, we pray for people everywhere who long for good news. Roll away the stones that keep people from living with dignity and wholeness. Breathe new life and hope into people who are struggling to make it through each day. God of grace, loving God, we pray for this community of faith and for your spirit in our midst. We pray for all who are sick or hospitalized, especially Pat, Annie, Sandra, Marilyn, Martha, Sarah, Vicky, Gisela, Harold, Larry, Mary, Jeanette, Susie, Karen, Frank, John, Debbie, Maya, Kim, and all those we name in our hearts. Feed us at your Easter table and fill us with your wisdom that we may serve and care for others. God of grace, eternal God, We remember those who have gone before us in death. Renew our trust in your promises that we live with joyful courage and compassion. God of grace, into your hands, most merciful God, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your abiding love through Jesus Christ, our resurrected and living Lord. Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always. Beloved, let us share that peace with one another.
Hallelujah! With the angels we will sing.
Please rise in body or in spirit for the offertory prayer. Risen One, you call us to believe and bear fruit. May the gift that we offer here be signs of your abiding love. Form us to be your witness in the world through Jesus Christ, our true vine. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, for the glorious resurrection of our Savior Jesus Christ, the true Paschal Lamb, who gave himself to take away our sin, who in dying has destroyed death, and in rising has brought us to eternal life. And so with Mary Magdalene and Peter and all the witnesses of the resurrection, with earth and sea and all their creatures, and with angels and archangels, cherubim and seraphim, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. God Triune, how majestic is your name in all the earth. Here by your wisdom are both life and death, growth and decay, sunshine and storm, darkness and light. Sustained by these wonders, we creatures of dust join in the ancient song, saying, the earth is full of your glory. O God Triune, you took on our flesh in Jesus, our healer. In Christ, you bring life from death. We remember his cross. We laud his resurrection. Broken like bread, he enlivens our body. Outpoured like wine, he fills the earth with goodness. Receiving this mystery, we mortals sing our song, saying, the earth is full of your glory. We praise you for the heart of Jesus, so filled with your love for this earth. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread. He gave thanks, blessed it, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, take and eat. This is my body, given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me. Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, poured out for you and for all people, for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Gathered around this table, we, your children, unite in this song, saying, "The earth is full of your glory. O God, triune, you create the worlds. You uphold the living. You embrace the dead. Send forth your spirit and renew the face of the earth. Give us a future that trusts in you and cares for your earth. Empowered by your promises, we rise from our deaths to praise you again, saying, the earth is full of your glory. Amen and amen.
Amen.
Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. A little different today, we will be starting communion, as you heard before, from the front row of the center aisle. As your usher directs you, you may come forward to flower the cross first, placing your flower and then moving to the stations by the rail. You may dispose of your cups in the baskets at the ends of the rail. From there, you will return to your seat. As the ushers get to the wing, you will go back out the doors and come up the center aisle so that you may take a flower and flower the cross. Those in the balcony, hi friends. It's good to see y'all up there too. The ushers will invite y'all to come down the stairs and enter through the center aisle as well. As you come forward for communion, please let us know if you need gluten-free or alcohol-free options. Those are available as you have need. Beloved, no matter who you are, where you have been, what you have done, or what has been done to you, there is grace for you. In this meal, we find a taste of that grace. In this meal, the risen Christ is made known to us. In this meal, we are fed with the bread of life. This is the body of Christ, given for you. Behold what you are. Become what you receive. Thanks be to God. I invite you to be seated.
Have mercy on us. Lamb of
God sent his son, they called him Jesus. He came to love, heal and forgive. He bled and died to buy my pardon. An empty grave is there to prove my Savior lives. Because he because he lives, how sweet to hold our newborn baby and feel the pride and joy he gives. But greater still, there's calm assurance this child can face uncertain days because Christ lives. Because I know this way to victory. I'll see the lights of glory and I'll know he reigns. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know he holds the future.
invite you to rise in body or in spirit. Now may this body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in God's grace unto life everlasting. Amen. Let us pray. Shepherding God, you have prepared a table before us and nourished us with your love. Send us forth from this banquet to proclaim your goodness and share the abundant mercy of Jesus, our Redeemer and friend. Amen. Now, beloved, may the Christ who walks on wounded feet walk with you on the road. May the Christ who serves with wounded hands stretch out your hands to serve. May the Christ who loves with a wounded heart open your hearts to love. May you see the face of Christ in everyone you meet. May everyone you meet see the face of Christ in you. Amen. Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed.
Alleluia. Alleluia. Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed. Alleluia.
Alleluia. Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed. Alleluia.
Alleluia. Go in peace. Rejoice and be glad.